be late to filming, and now my heart is beating a mile a minute because my dog decided it was the perfect time to need to go outside, like 3 minutes before I'm due to hit record. And I'm like, no, and I race down there. But hello, good day again. Thank you for joining me. I'd like to welcome you all to this video. Do not look away. Yes, it is Denise. I just happen to be wearing my hair down. Also, just as a side note, the odds of my dog barking really loud during the recording of this video are extremely high. So if that happens, I'm sorry in advance. The joys of having a dog. Anyways, today we are diving into a very interesting topic. And this is something I see often in my client work in terms of like making connections with some of the clients that I'm working with. And that is connecting the past to how it is showing up and mirroring itself in the present. And here's what I mean when I say mirroring. Oftentimes what happens to us when we're quite young, and it can be like either below 8 or over 8, no matter what happens, if we experience some sort of trauma or we have some sort of issue around attachment or receiving love and care from our primary caregivers, if we feel abandoned when we're younger, we adopt strategies to be able to survive essentially as a child, to be able to be like, okay, I need to make it to the next minute. Because as children, we're like, okay, even if I'm on my own, you know, like we're still evolutionarily speaking, we still have those fight, flight, or freeze mechanisms even at a young age, and even if we don't know we're using them. So if something happens to us in childhood and we feel like we need to kick it into survival mode, we will start adopting patterns of behavior to be able to manage and make it through to the next moment. Even as children, it just comes organically, naturally, and it is biologically sound. So that is something you need to keep in mind. So when I talk about the past being mirrored in the present, what I'm talking about are all those strategies you adopted when you were younger in order to survive, in order to feel good, in order to feel better, in order to, you know, feel validated. Essentially, you're bringing a lot of those patterns into the present, unless at some point in the trajectory of your life, you have made those connections or you've worked with a coach or a therapist or somebody to get to the root of why I continuously seem to be stuck in a cyclical pattern. I feel like I'm just living my life on repeat over and over and over, like the same patterns of behavior, the same things happen to me, the same toxic people come in and out of my life. I seem to attract the same things over and over and over again. There must be something wrong with me. And because what I want to do moving forward is always be tying supposed to culture into this. And if you have not heard me talk about supposed to culture before, it is the driving factors behind why we feel like we need to look outside of ourselves for answers, as opposed to connecting to our intuitive body and looking within. And these can be things like patriarchy, it could be capitalism, it could be consumerism, any of these influences that make you feel like you are not good enough just as you are. That is really what supposed to culture is. Some people might liken it to societal expectations, but it's like way, way, way deeper than that. So I want to make sure moving forward, whatever I'm talking to, I'm always connecting how supposed to culture influences whatever topic I'm talking about. So if we're talking about the past being mirrored in the present, and if we're talking about the trajectory of your life, and if you haven't yet addressed or made connections between what happened in childhood with what is going on in the present moment, if you haven't sought support or looked, you know, perhaps you were started engaging in some sort of self-development or self-healing or looking at podcasts. If you didn't do any of that, but you had that inkling that things are on repeat, this could be the influence of supposed to culture. Because obviously still, unfortunately, when it comes to things like therapy or counseling or coaching, there is this like stigma. I don't know why I'm putting stigma in quotations, because it is very real. It is not like some fallacy. There is a stigma around seeking that support, and there is a shame associated with it because it means there's something wrong with you. Now that should be in quotations. That is the thing I should be saying, something wrong with you. Because really at the end of the day, there is nothing wrong with you. You've just adopted certain strategies from childhood that haven't been addressed and healed, and they have remained wounds and have left an emotional imprint on you, and you have just been repeating the same things all through life. But maybe you thought to yourself, maybe counseling is for me. Maybe I do need a therapist. Maybe I do need somebody to be able to kind of dig deep with me and understand what's going on here and get to the root of some of these things that I keep seeing over and over and over again in my adult life. But then there's that shame and guilt, right? Like, oh, like if I go to the therapist, they might think I'm crazy, or maybe I, it might like, this is, it's not big enough for me. Maybe I need to have more trauma to be able to go see a therapist. And you start to talk yourself out of it. And that's the influence of supposed to culture that says, if you're not sunshine and rainbows all the time, there is something wrong with you. But trust me, there is nothing wrong with you. And if you are stuck in repeated patterns of behavior, please know that this is not your fault. This is something that you have adopted as a young child in order to survive. And I thought I might start off with a little example with one of my own clients. Now she has found herself in repeated patterns of behavior in terms of like same type of relationships over and over and over and over and over again. You know, she seems to be continually attracting narcissistic partners, people that, you know, really shower her with love and affection up in the beginning. But then as time goes on, this really turns into an emotionally abusive relationship. But, and her and I have had lots of conversations around this, and she kind of said, I don't understand why I keep having these same patterns of behavior. Like, what is going on in my life that I keep attracting the same type of men, that I keep falling for these same type of love bombing strategies? And if you don't know what love bombing is, it's essentially what a narcissistic person will use in order to bait somebody that is like, they feel like they could control, that are malleable, that they can get under their thumb and really exert their power over them. So what they do in the beginning phase is like the relationship moves way too quickly. First of all, it's like, I love you. You're the most amazing thing. I want to shower you with gifts. I want to spend every moment with you. You're the love of my life. And this is happening like in the first 7 seconds of a relationship. Like, they are just hitting you with compliments and love. And what's happened in this situation, and why sometimes big-hearted empaths are really subjected to this kind of narcissistic behavior, is because there was a wounding in childhood or a need that was not met. And in this particular case, this could boil down to a lot of things, but for her specifically, there was some, and I don't want to get into too many details because I want to respect her privacy, her confidentiality, but there was some issues around the relationship with her father. So she, in essence, was searching for that closeness with somebody that she lacked with her dad. So over and over and over again, she's been looking for that immediate closeness with somebody of the opposite sex. But unfortunately, she hadn't addressed that wound just yet. So it kept playing itself out, and she kept attracting narcissistic partners and didn't understand why. But what was happening was she was replaying this need to have a relationship, a close relationship, a close bond with a male figure, that this is what left her open to this. And now, by God, if you saw her now, like, I wish I could have her share some of her story, but for confidentiality purposes, I can't. Like, she's just a rock star. The fact that she has addressed so much of this now in her adulthood, and she recognizes that this is a pattern from the past, and it is on a consistent loop over and over and over and over again, but it's not necessarily what she's doing in the present moment. It's that she hadn't addressed the wounding from the past, so it is now being mirrored in the present. So she's still like that young child, that little part of her psyche, her soul, just wants daddy's love and affection and pay attention to me, please see me, please hear me. And then that ends up playing itself out as she looks for new relationships. But man, as she's done so much work. And now that she has addressed that, now she's aware of it, because so much of what's going on here is in the subconscious. You don't even know that you are having these patterns or doing these same things over and over and over again, because there's a direct link to the past, because that has kind of been buried into the subconscious mind and has now become habitual. But if you start to dig deep, and if you start to understand, okay, what's going on behind the surface here? And that's a lot of the work that we do in my program, is we dig a little bit deeper and we start to get a little bit curious, and we start to really, really observe and understand and notice the patterns, and then we trace them back. And that can be a little bit scary, like, don't get me wrong, but I'm there to support you every step of the way. And that's one thing I think my clients would really say, is that I make this a really safe process, and I make it so it's not so scary, and we do it together step by step. But as we dove deep and we understood, okay, here's some of the root of this, now she's like, wait a minute, I can do this for myself. Now she's at the point where she's really looking inwards and connecting to her own needs and validating herself. And she recognizes where those patterns are, and she can catch herself in them almost immediately. Almost immediately. Sometimes it's not 100%. I'm playing with my hair because I can't stand the hair in my face. It's besides the point. But if you're wondering why I'm touching it, that's why. But yes, so much of what you're doing now is a direct mirror to your childhood. And I'll give you a personal example of mine. I was always told when I was a kid, you're too loud, you're too noisy, you're too much. And I tried to be somebody I wasn't when I was a kid. And funnily enough, even as children, we were influenced by supposed to culture. These little children were probably at that time making fun of me because I was different than them. I was louder. I was quirky. I was immature. I did like to make people laugh. I do have a lisp. And they noticed, and this could have been their own upbringing. There could have been many factors at play here. They might not have had a conscious awareness that supposed to culture was influencing them, but they saw something different in me. And anytime people see something different in you, that's when supposed to culture is going to trigger. That's when you're going to start to say, oh, that's where judgment comes in. Like, oh, she's a little bit different. Let's make fun of her. And I was bullied a ton just for being loud and boisterous and being myself. So what happened was I carried so much of that with me. And anytime, and now here's the thing, it's like I couldn't necessarily hide who I was. I tried really hard. I tried to wear a mask. I tried to pretend I wasn't loud. I tried to pretend I didn't have this big boisterous voice. I tried to hide my personality. I tried to be something I wasn't. But this is like so natural to me, obviously. I mean, you see me here all the time. This is my natural personality. So there was only so much hiding that I could do. But what it did bring was shame. And that was what I was carrying from childhood: shame for being loud, shame for having a lisp, shame for not looking at like the other girls, and that feeling that I wasn't good enough. And what happened then is that I carried that shame with me, and that shame morphed into self-doubt. And it wasn't until I started therapy that I made all those connections. When I started looking at my own self-doubt, and if you suffer from self-doubt as well too, this is an activity you might want to try, because this is something that is being mirrored from the past that is still happening in the present moment. And if you trace back, where did this self-doubt come from? You're going to find a couple key pieces in your life where this came from. And for me, it came from feeling ashamed of who I was and being different and standing out when I was a child. And as I got older, that morphed into self-doubt. And I can think of one specific moment that triggered it even further when I was in high school and I didn't get the part of Peter Pan, and it's a whole big thing. But trust me, if I remember it this clearly, it has had an imprint on my life. So that continued to trigger it. And when that happened, then it morphed into self-doubt. So you can see how some of this stuff that is happening in childhood, in these early childhood experiences, whether they're like big T trauma, like abuse or neglect or abandonment, things like that, you can see how it morphs. And you continue to carry it with you into your adulthood. And until I started therapy, until I started working with my own counselor and understanding, I could not make those connections. I had no idea that my self-doubt in the present moment had all of these, like when I looked back, I could follow it right to the very moment where it started. But you don't really have the wherewithal when you're not going through it, because you're in it, you're living your life. And it's become so habitual, all the things that you're doing, you might wonder like, well, and you probably, this is how it manifests. You're probably like wondering like, what is wrong with me? Like, why do I keep going through the same thing over and over and over again? Like, what is happening here? I just keep banging my head against the wall, doing the same things over and over again. Every time I say I'm going to change, and every time I fail. And then you get into the rhetoric of I'm a failure, I'm not good enough, and more self-doubt happens. So you can see how this becomes really, really, really cyclical. But what I do with my client work is that we stop the spiral and we go back in time. We take the Back to the Future car and go back. Don't ask me why that's the reference I'm using. That's hilarious. That's what came to my mind. But this does take work, you know. And I'll give you another example too. This just came to me. So I think, and I'm gonna give you an example of how this happens with a man, because I think that's also, even as women, you know, we're always like, as much as men think we're like mysterious and stuff, us as women are like, what the heck makes men tick? I don't understand. So my previous husband, my ex-husband that we ended up separating and divorcing because he was a serial cheater and a sex addict. Now, when I look back on this, and I didn't have the capacity to look back on this and understand how his past was influencing his present moment. I could not put those things together. But now I can look back on it and say, when he was 2 years old, his mother abandoned him and just left without word, just took off, and he never saw her again for the rest of his life. So at 2 years old, he was missing the love, the connection, the emotionality from a mother. Now, he did have a stepmother, but on, you know, I think I don't know the history of all that there, but I don't know that the stepmother came in soon enough to be able to fill that void in the same amount of time, in the correct amount of time, I guess, in the time he needed. He was missing that, and he had a dad that was working like over the top working, and he had a grandparent that was always berating him for being too thin. So you can see how not having that love and affection then repeats itself. And this is perhaps, and I don't know 100% for certain, because I'm not an expert in sex addiction, but I do know that addiction is always covering pain. So in my mind, as a sex addict, he was using that closeness and that connection to feel something, to feel like it was filling a void, to feel like a need was being met. And then it became, you know, after doing it and doing it and doing it and feeling good in that moment and feeling like he had that connection and closeness, it then became an addiction, and then it became an obsession. And that is how his past was repeating itself in the present. Now, I don't know if he's addressed that at all in his present day, because I don't have contact with him, obviously, but I can look back and I can understand why things happened to him. Right? It's always going to be the same. The wounding that happens to you when you were a child, if it is not addressed, dragged my foot across the floor. If it is not addressed somewhere along the way in the trajectory of your life, it is going to manifest in the present and continue to be that way. I always say, like, it's almost like carrying a backpack, you know? And when you have a challenging experience, or if you have a traumatic experience, it leaves an imprint on your psyche. It's like you put another rock in your backpack, and you put another rock in your backpack, and you continue to carry this backpack. It's like you're born and they're like, here's your backpack, you know? Like, and you continue to carry it, and you collect more rocks, and you collect more rocks, and you collect more rocks. And then it's just like, oh my God, like, this is so heavy. I can't carry this anymore. Not realizing that you have the ability to be able to go into that backpack and start looking at those rocks and understanding where it came from and letting go of the ones that no longer serve. But that is a process. And that is, again, some of the work that I do with my clients is going through that backpack full of traumatic rocks and understanding the influence it's had on your life and understanding why it is having an impact on the present moment, and then slowly starting to work through each of them, allowing them to be put aside so you can lighten your load. And, you know, I'm actually working right now in fine tuning what my method is, but one of the pillars of my method is exhale. And it's the third stage of my method, where you get to this point and you've gone through some of the backpack, you're like, oh, I can breathe. Oh my God, I can breathe. I didn't even realize I wasn't breathing. I didn't realize the weight that I was carrying with me from all of these rocks that were in my backpack. And now I am ready to release my attachment to them. Now I am ready to break some of these patterns that have become habits, but it's going to take your attention. It is going to require you to be like, okay, I am ready to do this work. And I understand that going through that backpack and understanding and unpacking some of those really potentially traumatic events is very, very, very scary. And again, this is that influence of supposed to culture that's like, just be sunshine and rainbows and just ignore everything and stick your head in the sand and don't address any of your problems and keep them to yourself. And, you know, people are going to think you're crazy. And what are other people going to think? They're all going to judge you for doing this now. And that's that chirp, chirp, chirp supposed to culture in your ear. And that's why so much of this goes unaddressed and why so many people have unresolved trauma in their life. And again, I've talked about trauma many, many times here in the community, and it's not necessarily what you think. So many people consider trauma to be big T trauma, meaning abuse, sexual assault, abandonment, neglect, all of these things. What I recognized in my own work is, yes, I do have some clients that have bigger T trauma, but where I specialize is in little T trauma. So people that grew up in chaotic households, that parents, maybe they were children of divorce, or they had parents that weren't always there for them emotionally, or they were bullied in school, or some of these things that's more like what you wouldn't make the connection of traumatic events, because I think people all think trauma is big T, but there's so many little T trauma things, and anything that's left an emotional imprint or taken an emotional snapshot, camera has one thing. I don't know what camera does this, but anytime you have an emotionally charged event, it leaves an emotional imprint on you, because the brain obviously remembers negative things really, really well. It remembers emotionally charged things. And if you were consistently reliving something that happened, even it doesn't even have to be childhood. It could have been in your adolescence. It could have been, like, for me, I had a traumatic marriage that took a snapshot. It left a traumatic imprint on my on my psyche, on my body, on my mind. It's something I relived consistently. It's something I really had to work on in terms of like trust and feeling like I was good enough. Because obviously after your partner cheats on you to such an extreme, you're left feeling like you aren't good enough. So it took me actually looking at that and being like, okay, wait a minute. No, this was not ever a me problem. This was never about me. This was something that he was struggling with, and he was just doing what he needed to survive. And I ended up being collateral damage, but it was never about me at the end of it all. But even that in itself, that was very traumatic. And it's, so it doesn't necessarily have to be mirrors from childhood. It could be mirrors from adolescence, from your teenage years, from your early 20s. Hey, it could be a repeating pattern of behavior that you adopted to survive like 3 or 4 years ago. So it doesn't necessarily have to be from childhood, but that is where I really specialize, is understanding how some of these events that, yes, were traumatic, first of all, having you admit and recognize how traumatic they were, and then working through and understanding what steps to do next to alleviate some of the weight and reach that point of like, oh, exhale. And that's like some of the biggest goals and some of the most profound moments my clients are having, is these moments where they're like, oh, I can let the weight of the world go. That's amazing. I didn't realize how much effort it took to continue to maintain these same patterns of behavior. Now that I've recognized it, and now that I'm starting to break that cycle little by little, like now I can finally breathe. Now I can finally breathe. Thank goodness. But you know, and so much of this work, you're probably wondering like, okay, Denise, what do I do now? Now I'm starting to think, okay, maybe, yeah, my past is really mirroring itself in the present moments. That like, what do I do next? What are my next steps? And I think the first step obviously is having awareness around it, because a lot of this stuff is going to be buried in the subconscious. And until you start to dig it up and make those connections on your own, it's going to be really difficult for you to recognize how the past is being mirrored in the present. So your first order of business is to understand and wonder about, okay, what patterns am I repeating? What do I feel like might be, like has been with me since childhood? Let me understand what those things are. Are they toxic friendships, toxic relationships? Is it the same type of job over and over again? No matter what it is, if you feel like there's a connection there, you have to understand and call it out and be like, whoa, what is it? Have awareness. That's the first step. And then the second piece of that is start to trace back the root. Be like, okay, where did this come from? Have I always done this? Or when's my earliest memory of doing this specific behavior, or of, you know, having this same pattern happen over and over? Like, what's the first time I can recollect it? And don't feel bad if you're like, I can't remember the first time. Often, anytime you have some sort of trauma or emotional imprint in your life, sometimes you actually forget. And your actual like body and your ego has done that on purpose to protect you. It buries it deep so you can't find it, so you don't have to experience it again. So you're gonna have to be really, really gentle with yourself while you do this exploration, because it could prove to be emotional. It could prove to be really upsetting sometimes, depending on what you're repeating and what behaviors are repeating from the past and being mirrored in the present. So you're gonna have to be really, really gentle while you do this and trace the line. If you can't get all the way back, that's okay, but at least it's a starting point. You might start to recognize things, and I think sometimes when you start to do this work, like stuff starts to come to you in dreams. Be mindful of your dreams as well, because your dreams are a portal to your psyche, to your subconscious. And if you're ready to kind of address something and look into it, and if you're at that point where you're like, okay, I'm ready, I'm at the point where I'm ready, you might start to have dreams that might not make sense, but when you kind of analyze them the next morning or in that moment, you'll be like, oh, okay, I'm being called to look at something, right? So you need to have awareness, you need to trace the roots back. And then after that, it's like, okay, what need am I trying to serve? Like, what need am I trying to fill that I keep doing this over and over again? Is it a need for closeness? Is it a need for connection? Is it a need for validation? A need to be seen and heard and recognized? What is the actual need that is being unmet? And then after you've discovered that, then it's like, how can I meet this need for myself? How can I do this for myself? How can I go within and start to address this internally, right? So those are just a couple of tips on how you can start to move through and navigate some of this, you know, this stuff from the past that's now in the present moment and just is like nails on chalkboard at this point, like, anyways, so yeah, hopefully you found that helpful. And obviously, you know, if this is work you're interested in doing, in the container that is therapy. Please let me know. Obviously, this is some of the profound work that I'm doing with my own clients, and I would love to have a conversation with you about how this could work for you and how my method and my system can support you in moving through some of this stuff. So if that is of interest to you, please reach out to me. I would be happy to talk to you about it. And if it's something you want to pursue, I can absolutely see if I have the space to take you on and we can start our work together. But with that, I'm going to go and eat something because I'm starving. And I will see you next time.